calling.
Thank you.
Lord, again, we need to pray. Father God, I come before you this morning in the name of Christ Jesus. I thank the Lord for those that have gathered here this morning, for the anointing upon them as Holy Spirit comes down in this place, in its fullness,
yes,
to minister to them. And I thank the Lord God that as I speak that which I have on these papers, Lord, that it will be anointed of you to minister to each and every one of them. And Lord, as I prayed earlier, if Holy Spirit has different ideas, I am open to do that too, in Jesus' name. And I thank you for it, Lord.
Amen.
Now I want to share a few minutes about the Holy Spirit and how he has worked in my life. Starting with John 20, 21 and 22. Then Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." I was led to understand that once I had prayed the prayer for salvation, the Holy Spirit was free to begin to work in me and make some changes. And he was doing that. But it took a while for me to notice. Actually, it was others who saw the changes first. After a couple of weeks, someone asked me, "What happened to you? You are no longer using foul language." As I was working this out in my mind, I had a wait a minute moment. The Holy Spirit didn't begin to work in me once I accepted Jesus. He was already working in me, or as you please, on me, to bring me to the point of salvation. When I made a commitment to live for the Lord, the Holy Spirit stepped up his activity in my life. He had me fellowshipping with seasoned believers who were eager to teach me as I was to learn. The most important thing I learned in those days was to listen and discern the voice of the Lord. And I heard him tell me frequently to read the Word. It took some time to move to the next step. That is the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:1-4. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Why would I hesitate to have such an experience? It's called confusion. On one hand, I had people who were telling me, "If you don't speak in tongues, you're not filled with the Spirit." The church I was attending were not supportive of the idea of speaking in tongues. Personally, I needed something more than what those around me were supplying me with concerning tongues, and that was hindering my ability to receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit in my life. The Holy Spirit is gracious. He led me to a couple of verses in 1 Corinthians 14:18-19. And it's Paul speaking. "I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all. Yet in a church I would rather speak 5 words with my understanding, that I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in a tongue." Now, when I thought about that, and I haven't got it written down, but my five words would be, Jesus Christ is my Lord. Five words. And I thank and praise Him for that. A few days later, I was in a meeting when I had a call to receive the Holy Spirit. And I went forward where they laid hands on me to receive. A man laid hands on me, and when I uttered one unintelligible word, declared I had received. The truth being, I had prayed to be filled before the meeting, and that was when I was filled. Eventually, I received the ability to pray in tongues, and I don't make a big deal of that. There are those who think speaking in tongues is the only proof that you are in the Spirit. So I'm going to share a couple of stories. I was fellowshipping with a close friend and neighbor one evening, as we did quite often. When I started to pray, I can't remember what the prayer was about, but I do remember when I quit praying, it was an hour later. My friend told me I had been in prayer for over an hour. The prayer was completely in English. Now, if I wasn't able to recall what I prayed, was I not praying in the Spirit? Another time, my wife and I were invited to a Christmas supper. At 6 p.m., I was given the task of blessing the food. I don't have much of a written memory of that evening, as the Holy Spirit came on me as I prayed for the meal and ministered through me to the other guests and our hosts until midnight. One of those guests was a former mayor of one of the local towns. Her comment to me was, I've been in a lot of meetings as a mayor, but never have I been in one like this where my attention was held every minute for 6 hours. I have to point out that in both of these situations, it was not me doing the praying or the ministry. It was the Holy Spirit working through me. There are a couple of other things the Holy Spirit taught me through ministry. We had a few people out to our place for pizza one night. And I was sharing that to me, the simplest of healings was the lengthening of a leg, which in truth is simply bringing the spine into alignment. One of our guests was a truck driver who, because of back problems, wasn't able to drive a big rig anymore. He requested that I demonstrate on him. When you make a statement, sometimes you have to prove it. When I checked his legs, the right one was about an inch shorter than the left. It seemed to be like the longest time, nothing happened. Then I felt the anointing and heard the Holy Spirit say, "Speak the name of Jesus." I did. And things started happening. It took a couple of minutes, but when it was over, both legs were the same length. The man eventually stood up and walked around the table a couple of times. Then he said, "For the first time in about 10 years, I have no back pain." The lesson I learned that night was, there's no such thing as a simple healing. Sometimes the Holy Spirit has to do some preliminary work before the healing manifests. When ministering, be prepared to wait until the Holy Spirit lets you know He's done. My next story is one that touches my heart as I share it, and it's fairly long, but I feel the need to share it. A mother, coming into the church I was attending, came to me and told me She had to take her daughter to have warts removed from her hands. I felt the Holy Spirit nudge me to lay hands on the child's head. I did as he instructed me, 3 Sundays in a row. The 4th Sunday, the child couldn't wait to show me her hands. It was as if there had never been any warts. The lesson was, even if it looks like nothing has happened, be persistent. When I act upon what I hear from the Holy Spirit, he will finish what he has started, even if it takes a little while. But that isn't the end of it. A year and a half later, we were having Christmas dinner. I do a lot of Christmas dinners with a young lady's family when she came to me and stated, "No, that would be more like demanded. You need to pray and get rid of some warts that have come back." I was preparing to fulfill her demand when the Holy Spirit took over and out of my mouth came, "You have the authority over your own body. You take authority over those warts in Jesus' name." She was a fast learner. She didn't wait to get in her prayer closet. She immediately rebuked the devil and those warts. A few days later, I received a message from her. The message was 3 words: "I have victory." Lesson: don't assume the Holy Spirit is going to do things the same way every time. It was a few years before the final segment of this story came to pass. Christmas 1999, to be exact. Because we were new in the church, a couple invited us for a Christmas dinner. 2 other couples were invited as well. After dinner, we were asked to share what the Lord had been doing in our lives. Because I had noticed that the youngest girl had warts on her feet, I shared the first half of the young girl's story. Later that evening, as we were preparing to leave, our host took me aside and asked if I would lay hands on the child's feet. The Holy Spirit stopped me before I could answer. After all, he knew I wouldn't hesitate to fill this father's request. Instead, he had me say, "You are the authority in her life. Therefore, you lay hands on her feet every night, taking authority over the warts until they are gone." The next Sunday, he came up to me and told me the warts had literally fallen off the child's feet. Lesson: check with the Holy Spirit every time someone makes a request or any type of ministry. He might have something else in mind for the situation. I still have one more scripture to deal with. Acts 4:29. "Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word." As many times as I have heard that prayer and read it, I have no recollection of praying it for myself until my prayer partner and I prayed it over ourselves and each other. That was last summer. I am finding that I, the guy who only shares when asked to, have become someone who will. And when I think about it, I not only will share, it is the desire of my heart to share my Lord with anyone that will listen. It is surprising how many people are ready to listen. Now, I have one short testimony that's up to date. And it's of the Holy Spirit working in and through me and for others. Last Sunday, our sister Nancy here was out of sorts when I came in. She indicated that the need for someone with anointing to lay on her hand, lay hands on her and pray for healing. I believe it was as much spiritual as physical. As we prayed for the service, I prayed for her. Then the Holy Spirit gave me a formula to walk her through for the healing. When she started praying for the service, there was no sign that she had been in a spiritual battle half an hour before. Was it me who did it? No. All I did was obey what the Holy Spirit told me. Now that's the end of what I've got written here. But I want to share what it was the Lord showed me last Sunday. And you're going to have to help me. Look at your hands. Say, these hands have healed. The Lord has given me healing in these hands. He has also given me any form of ministry that I need through these hands. God has anointed these hands. Now lay a hand on yourself. Thank you, Lord, that these healing hands have been laid on each and every person here. And that the healing is flowing forth because Holy Spirit is in it. And I sense, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit is ministering to each and every one of these people. And in me, and if I don't take my hand off my chest, I'm going over. I thank and praise you, Lord God, that the healing is in this church. The ability to minister is in each person here. And as for those that are on the internet, if you have done this with me, you have received the Holy Spirit's ministry in your life also. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now I want to pray to close. Heavenly Father, and as we close this part of the service, Lord, I thank and praise you. The Holy Spirit has come down and met with us here today. This may not have not been a typical sermon, Lord, but I feel that that is what you wanted me to speak. And I thank and praise you, Lord God, that as you minister to each one of them through what I have said and what I've shared, that they will be blessed abundantly in Jesus' name. And I thank the Lord God. That's it.
Lord, have mercy on me, a pure heart, 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 Lord, Dear God, I pray over each and every one who has joined us in person and online, Father God. I pray that you would bless them, keep them, and make your face to shine upon them and be gracious unto them. Take them through this week. Take them on to higher ground. In you it is all possible. So we love and we place our trust in you. We pray that your spirit is moving in these people and out through online. We thank you for it. We love you for it. And we trust in you. And we be your examples, Lord, of your love. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You're all dismissed.